10 years of being in the public eye, 13 albums and a wealth of words should tell you something about the workings of an artist. But do they, when the artist is David Bowie? We won't pretend that this program cracks any codes, opens any secret doors, but it does throw a new light on his appreciation of other performers. There are some famous names here, some you've never heard of before, but they all acquire a kind of fame in the Bowie record collection.
Hello, this is David Bowie. It's a bit grey out today, but I've got some Perrier water, and I've got a bunch of records. I think if I was walking outside at the moment, I would like to be walking on this street. It's Love Street by the Doors. A commanding performer. I remember seeing him once at, I think it was the Roundhouse, when they came to London the first time. I believe I'm right. Somebody else that I think is working at the Roundhouse over the next few weeks, a buddy of mine, Iggy Pop. This is just something that I remember with affection because it's when I was with him on tour playing piano for him. This one's called TVI. Also on piano is a gentleman. I think this is the really despondent track. He left his band and he was doing his first solo album, and I found it rivetingly depressing. Really enjoyed playing it to myself. It's called Remember by John Lennon. Very good piano. I think it's Billy Preston, actually. Right. Let's play Love Street again. No. Growing up and being angry. That's what this one was all about. 96 Tears by Question Mark and the Mysterians, which nobody has in their record collection. Yes, they've actually got it here. Good old Beeb. That's an extraordinary piece of music. There was another incredible, what are they called? The 13th Floor Elevators. I can't remember that one very well. That was around the same period, I think. I guess some punk freak will sort of correct me on that. This is a punk that I was incredibly impressed by this one when I first heard it. It was a real use of music in describing a situation musically, and it's also nice and short, but it's classical music. It's very good. You see what you think it describes. It's by Elgar. It was in fact a wagon. I expect you guessed, didn't you? It was from the nursery suite. Oh, and here's another nursery song. This one's interesting because I thought it was an extraordinary thing to use numbers as backing vocals, and that I really like that idea. And I've just heard it again, but here's the first one that I heard. It was Inchworm by Danny Kaye. Okay, so that's one use of numbers. And now if you want to get very modern, there's a chappie called Phillip Glass. Listen how he uses numbers. I think probably his music could point to a particular direction that music may be, or some aspect of music may be going in at the moment. This is from an opera that he wrote, which was about 15 and a half years long. And they sort of put some selections out on this album called Einstein on the Beach. And this particular piece is called Trial Prison. And there's a lovely little narration in it by one of the singers. It'll be on the left-hand side of your speaker if you've got stereo. On the right-hand side if you've got them plugged in the wrong way round. first single that I heard when I first went to America on the first day that I got there was in New York, and I was taken over to a writer's apartment that he had in, I think it was probably on 8th Avenue somewhere, and he played me a new album that had just come out, and he was very excited about this track, and so was I. And I expect you were when you heard it as well. It was Sweet Jane by the Velvet Underground. From the sublime to the ridiculous, Brian Eno put together a compilation album of four new bands from America, one of them called Mars. I'm not particularly fond of much of the album, but this one piece of music bowled me over. I think it's superb. It's called Helen Fordsdale. How about that lot? It reminds me of, I think it's Min from The Goon Show, doesn't it, you? Helen Fordsdale! It's the most eccentric voice I've heard in years. It's incredible. This is quite absurd as well. Guess who this is? It's called He's a Star. I think I've got the title right. I couldn't believe this when I first heard it. That was Little Richard. That's a far cry, isn't it? He had this strange thing where he threw all his rings and everything away and became a preacher for a bit. And this was an outcome of that, when he started doing sort of gospel music and church music. But how he changed his voice like that, I must have given up something else, I think. This is... If you fancy yourself as a schizophrenic, I think this becomes your theme song. I used to love this one. 21st Century Schizoid Man by young Robert Fripp's very exciting band, King Crimson. Here's a band that I admire very much. Some very, very charming people, David Byrne in particular. They're talking about Talking Heads, of course. Here's a track from, I think it was their last album, more songs about buildings and food. I found this very impressive. It took me back, actually, to the days of the early Yardbirds. I don't know why. It's called Warning Sign. Birds, of course, leads in very beautifully to Jeff Beck. This was a piece of music that he wrote, and I think they must have done it in about 4.5 minutes. It really sounds as though it's thrown together, but like all classics, it still shoots out of the speakers. It's called Beck's Bolero. Here's a song that made me fall in love with the singer. Absolutely incredible. My heart went straight out to her. And it was produced by Phil Spector. I may be wrong, but I think it's the last single that he ever made, and because he was so depressed that it didn't do anything, that nobody bought it. Which is quite ironic, really, because the title was Try Some, Buy Some, and it's by his ex-wife, Ronnie Spector.
Way back in time, someone said try some, I tried some.
Here's a guy that probably did as much for the early 70s sound in England as Spector did to the 60s sound in America. Single-handedly changed an awful lot of what was happening sound-wise in England. It's my old buddy Mark Bolan, and the song's called 20th Century Boy. which you always will be. Okay, here's some guys that follow in the tradition of what young Mark was laying down, I suppose. They're called the Mekons. I hope they gig a lot, because they deserve to with this track. It's called Where Were You? It has a beautiful sort of velvet underground top guitar over it. There's a new singer. I don't know if he's a new singer. He's probably his dad's heard him for years, but, I mean, he's new to me anyway. His name's Steve Forbert. This is a track from his new album. I like it particularly because one of my old band is on it. Dave Sanborn is playing saxophone on it. It's called Big City Cat. Running out of things to play you. Oh, no, I tell you what. This is another kind of love song. This is also by the Stones. This one's called We Love You. I'm sure they mean it. Another very deserving band, this one. I think this also caught everybody's imagination, especially if you liked Humphrey Bogart. It was called 2HB. Very clever pun, isn't it? Isn't that a clever pun? And it's by Roxy Music. You see, if you're an artist, a 2HB is a pencil, you see. 2HB, do you get it? HB means Humphrey Bogart. That's a pun. It is. It's a pun. Roxy Music thought that up. Here's a great writer. I don't like what he's doing very much now. I loved this album when it came out. It was on Asbury Park. Bruce Springsteen. And after I heard this track, I never rode the subway again. It's called Saint in the City. That really scared the living ones out of me, that. Here's one that also scared me because it was so incredibly adventurous in at the time when it was released. It's by Stevie Wonder. And it's a startling piece called Fingertips. Let's bring back the good weather again. Let's try very hard, anyway. Now, what can we do that with? I think we can probably do it... Let's leave it to Blondie. A little sort of up-tempo thing called Rip Her to Shreds. How about that, then? Lovely Little Debbie. It's got a good hook. As Kierkegaard always used to say, has he got a good hook? Sad, that one. Really quite sad. I'm sorry that so many of these are so sad. Must say something about... Oh, it's the weather, you know. It's the weather. It's either that or these shoes. It really hurt... Make toes hurt in between. I've got these strange sort of Japanese sandals on. And, they hurt your toes a bit. Anyway, it's not hurting the music. It's not fair. It doesn't worry you, does it? Does it worry you? Okay. This one's called Beautiful Loser, and it's by Bob Seger. Now, I'm not sure about that one. I think it's quite nice. I only played it because it's got the word Lodger in it, and that's my new album title. But that's... you don't have to worry about that. It's just an ego problem. Here's a track from my album. It's called Boys. that song really does have a problem. Really does have a problem. Well, whilst we're still on the same subject, here's one that I wrote. I started writing this in Berlin, and I ended up finishing the thing in New York. It's got a sort of a Turkish quality to it. I find it quite hypnotic. I think it's one of my favourite tracks on the album. It's called Yassassin. Yassassin, if it's of any interest to you, means long life in Turkish. I didn't know that. I had to phone up the Turkish embassy and find out what it meant. I read it on a wall. I read most things on the wall. I read Kierkegaard on a wall. He speaks highly of me as well. Oh, well, as we're talking about books and things, here's the book I read by Talking Heads. That was Talking Heads. You see, they're different to me. I mean, they actually go and read the books. They've never read any walls. I've read them on a wall, though. Next to Kierkegaard. Here's a smashing Roxy Music track. It's called For Your Pleasure. And I love the ta-ra at the end. It's a beautiful gesture. I saw them in concert the other week in New York. It was very good. Did you, any of you see it? The new show. I'm quite pleased they reformed. Their bass player is very good. Awfully good bass player. And he jumps very well. They've got a good jumping bass player, you know, Roxy Music. Excellent. One of the best little jumpers I've seen. This is a mess. No, this is a track by King Curtis, who's a fine musician, and I hope you enjoy it. It's called Something on Your Mind. And here are three girls who've got a very musical dad, and one of the girls is very, very sexy, and I keep playing her records over and over again when I'm on my own. It's the Staple Singers and it's called Lies. Now, she breathes very well, doesn't she? Lies. I mean, the Roxy Music guy jumps better, but she can really breathe. She does a good breathe. Well, I'm afraid I can't find any more to play. So, I'm going to, I bought three of these records along myself, by the way. I'll tell you which ones I brought along, because I knew they wouldn't have them here. It's not their fault. Shops were closed. I bought the Mekons, Where Were You? That's mine. Phillip Glass, Einstein on the Beach, that's mine as well. And, the No New York album with the wonderful Mars track, that's mine as well. Thought I'd let you know that. I'm going out to write my name on a wall now. Maybe I'll meet you at the wall. Back to the walls, chaps. Okay, ta-ra.
David Bowie, and after 2 hours in the studio, you can bet he really meant that closing statement. The David Bowie Star Special was produced by Stuart Grundy. Next week, well, it's one of those weeks when we wish we could provide a picture too, because the guest DJ will be Tina Turner.